Good morning and welcome this morning to Central United Methodist Church. We are glad that you are here, whether you are joining us here in person or whether you are joining us online. It is Memorial Day weekend. Happy Memorial Day to all of you as we spend this weekend contemplating the sacrifice that was made by so many that gives us the freedom to gather today and worship. And I know some people are out enjoying this long holiday weekend. They're fully vaccinated and are taking this opportunity to go see family and friends that they haven't seen in quite a while. Here in Douglas County, our mask, our mask mandate has been lifted. And so we are letting you decide this day. If you want to continue to wear your mask, we honor that and respect that. If you would like to take it off and are socially distanced, we honor that as well. We do ask you to remember, though, that we do have some children who are not old enough yet to receive the vaccine, and so we want to be careful when we are in their presence. So just keep that in mind as we are coming back to worship this day. For those of you who are joining us online, we would ask that you would leave a comment under the Facebook video or the YouTube video, if you're watching that way, to let us know that you are here and worshiping with us this day. That place is also an opportunity for you to share any joys or concerns that you would like shared here among the community. You're always welcome to email the church as well and let us know, and we will make sure that we get those things added to our prayer list and our announcement time. As we gather, I have a little hairball this morning. As we gather and prepare to worship this day, I would ask for you to join in our call to worship that will be led by Stacy Reisner. If you are here and are able and willing to stand, we invite you to do so at this time. And the words for your responses will be on the screen.
Give the Lord glory and power. Adore the Lord, splendid and holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of God's glory. Heed the voice of the Lord, full of power. Regard the voice of the Lord, full of splendor. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The world is full of God's glory. The God of glory thunders. The Lord's voice flashes flames of fire. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of God's glory. In God's temple, the people cry glory, for the Lord will give strength to the people. The Lord will bless the people with peace.
And would you please join in our opening prayer? God, God of majesty and power, how awesome you are to us. The mountains tremble at the sound of your name. Yet you have chosen to come to us in love and tenderness.
You have called us to be people
who will act in ways of peace and justice to your world.
Open
our hearts and our spirits, Lord, to hear your word, and having heard, to act in ministries of hope and peace for all your earth. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You might remember we have been learning a new song for this summer. It's called Days of Elijah. That will be our opening song this day, and the words will be on your screen.
Thank you.
morning. As we move into a time of prayer, I have a few prayer concerns to lift up for us this morning. Krista, Becky, Missy, and Milo all request prayers for their dear friend Jean, who is dealing with prostate cancer. So our prayers are with Jean as he navigates this diagnosis and all that comes with it. The next request is also from Krista Campbell. A couple of months ago, you might remember that we prayed for Anna May, who was involved in a car accident and broke several ribs. So yesterday, unfortunately, she took a turn for the worse. So please pray for peace for Anna May and for her family during this difficult time. And a joy for us, Ben Hansen is home from Army National Guard basic training. So we celebrate him with him and with the Hansons, who are happy to have him back. For whom else shall we pray this morning? Yes. The Camerons and the, sorry, who? The Coes? Copes? Okay. Yeah, so prayers for the surgery and prayers for family relations and what sounds like a difficult time. Please join me at this time in the prayer of confession. The words are on the screen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we often forget that you are the ruler of our lives. Instead, we turn our attention elsewhere. We want what others have. We allow the concerns of the world to weigh us down. We become distracted by the activities around us. We forget to keep our focus on you. Forgive us. Strengthen our faith, that we may see your presence in our lives. Remind us again that you are the Lord of our lives, the one who loves us completely, the one who offers us abundant forgiveness, the one who never leaves our side. In your holy name we pray. Gracious and loving God, even when we do not sense you with us, you are here. Even when we do not know the direction you want us to go, you go before us and walk beside us in our fear and trembling. Help us to become aware of the ways you work in our lives, as individuals and as a community. Give us ears to hear your voice, eyes to see the way you have set before us, and hands and feet to embody your love in our world. O God, we pray this day in acknowledgement of the many needs of our world, both far and near. And so we pray for those around the world who are hungry, thirsty, and without shelter. For those experiencing oppressive occupation of their land. For those who know firsthand the sting of racial injustice. For those who grieve. For those who are sick or injured. For those longing for connection. For those in need of a break. For those who long for change, be with us, O God. Surround us with your loving presence, that your love would nourish us to love the world. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Sorry for all of the microphone issues. This day I have a new one. I'm getting used to it. Would you please join in our next song, Surely the Presence of the Lord. We'll sing it through twice and the words will be on your screen.
These words from Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. In the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, in order that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished, the Lord stirred up the spirit of King Cyrus of Persia so that he sent a herald throughout all his kingdom, and also in a written edict declared, "Thus says King Cyrus of Persia, the Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem in Judah. Any of those among you who are of his people, may their God be with them, are now permitted to go to Jerusalem in Judah and rebuild the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. He is the God who is in Jerusalem, and let all survivors in whatever place they reside be assisted by the people of their place with silver and gold, with goods and with animals, besides freewill offerings for the house of God in Jerusalem."
May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of his holy word. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and redeemer. Open us to your Spirit's presence this morning and to the message that you have for each of us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, last week we started a new sermon series called Going Home, What the Israelites Returned to Jerusalem from Exile Can Teach Us Today. And so we are continuing that, and we will learn about another person who played an important role in the story of the Israelites' return to Jerusalem after they were in exile. Today we're going to hear about Zerubbabel. It's a fun name to say, thank you. So, Zerubbabel, he was appointed as the governor over Judea at the time of the return from exile, and he was given the task of rebuilding the temple. But before we look at his story, let's take a quick look at a couple of things from last week that it's important to remember today. The kingdom of Judah, this was the southern kingdom of Israel after the kingdom divided. Judah was conquered by the Babylonian Empire, and the Babylonians were later conquered by the Persian Empire. And many of the Israelites were taken into exile in the land of Babylon. And around 538 BCE, the Persian emperor, Cyrus the Great, allowed them to return back to the promised land. Well, now that the COVID-19 pandemic is not disrupting life as much as it has been these last 15 months, people are beginning to return, or at least trying to return, to a lifestyle that feels more normal, whatever normal means, the way it was prior to the pandemic. But just like the Israelites returning to Jerusalem after a 70-year exile, we might be discovering that what we are returning to doesn't look the same as it did before. That applies to our lives personally, and it applies to the church as well. We have been worshiping and ministering very differently for a little over a year. Some of the things that we did before aren't being done now. And we're doing some things now that we weren't doing 15 months ago. It might not be possible to return to church exactly how we knew it. And even if it is possible, it doesn't mean that we should. There are things that should have been done all along that haven't been, and things that should have been done weren't. So returning from exile provides an opportunity to start over, to have a rebirth, and to rebuild a church that obeys the command of Christ to go and make disciples. Zerubbabel had to rebuild a church literally. When the Babylonians conquered the southern kingdom of Judah, they destroyed Solomon's temple. The temple was looted, it was robbed of its vessels. The vessels were things that were used in the performances of rituals and sacrifices in the temple. They were made of precious metals, gold, silver, and so they were valuable. They were worth something. So anything that was worth value from the temple was taken out, and then the temple was destroyed and burned down. When the exiles were given permission to return to Jerusalem, it also gave them permission to be worshiping God again, to worship Yahweh. And an important part of that worship was offering sacrifices. Now, the Jewish people were required to make blood atonement for their sins, their individual sins, as well as corporate sins of the community. Now, we no longer have to worry about doing that because Christ's death on the cross provides an ultimate blood atonement for our sins. We don't have to sacrifice a dove or a lamb or any other animal. We confess our sins, we ask for forgiveness, and then those sins are covered by the blood of Jesus and the blood of the cross. But that wasn't the case for the Israelites. So Zerubbabel first led an effort to rebuild the altar, the place where those sacrifices could occur. And then the rebuilding of the temple began. Ezra 3, 8 through 13 tells the story of the foundation of the temple being laid. So let me share that with you now. In the second year after their arrival at the house of God in Jerusalem, in the second month, Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and Yeshua, son of Jozadak, made a beginning together with the rest of their people, the priests and the Levites, and all who had come to Jerusalem from the captivity. They appointed the Levites from 20 years old and upward to have the oversight of the work on the house of the Lord. And Yeshua with his sons and his kin, and Kadmiel and his sons, Binui and Hodaviah, along with the sons of Henadad, the Levites, their sons and kin, together took charge of the workers in the house of God. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments were stationed to praise the Lord with trumpets, and the Levites, son of Asaph, with cymbals according to the directions of King David of Israel. And they sang responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever toward Israel. And all of the people responded with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of family, old people who had seen the first house on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of the people's weeping, for the people shouted so loudly that the shout was heard far away. In the text that Stacy shared with us, we're told that the people who lived in the lands neighboring Judah were supposed to help with the construction costs by giving silver, gold, animals, goods, and money to the cause. Now you need to remember, Israel, the kingdom of Judah, was not the only people and nation that was occupied. All of the surrounding countries around were also under the control of the Persians. So when Cyrus said, you can go back and you can rebuild the temple, he sent along money with them to do that. But he also told the neighboring kingdoms, by the way, you're going to contribute to this cause as well. Well, as you can imagine, that didn't go over too well. So the governors of those lands sent letters to King Antaxerxes, king of Persia, trying to sabotage the building efforts of the Israelites. They told the king that once this wicked and rebellious city of Jerusalem was rebuilt, well, then the Israelites, they're going to rebel, and they're not going to pay their taxes to the empire anymore. So work on the temple stopped for a time while they awaited the king's decision. But in the meantime, the prophets Haggai and Zechariah prophesied to the Israelites that the time to rebuild the temple was now, and construction resumed. Haggai said this in chapter 2, verses 4 to 9. Yet now take courage, O Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Take courage, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Take courage, all you people of the land, says the Lord. Work, for I am with you, says the Lord of hosts, according to the promise that I made you when you came out of Egypt. My spirit abides among you. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once again, in a little while, I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all the nations so that the treasure of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with splendor, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The latter splendor of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give prosperity. So with that encouragement, construction started up again. But the other kings, they didn't give up. Next, they wrote to King Darius to see if he would order the construction to be stopped. But Darius would have none of it. His response to them is found in Ezra chapter 6. Let the work on this house of God alone. Let the governor of the Jews and the elders of the Jews rebuild this house of God on its site. Moreover, I make a decree regarding what you shall do for these elders of the Jews for the rebuilding of this house of God. The cost is to be paid to these people in full and without delay, from the royal revenue, the tribute of the province beyond the river. Whatever is needed, young bulls, rams or sheep for burnt offerings to the God of heaven, wheat, salt, wine, or oil, as the priests in Jerusalem require, let that be given to them day by day without fail, so that they may offer pleasing sacrifices to the God of heaven and pray for the life of the king and his children. Furthermore, I decree that if anyone alters this edict, a beam shall be pulled out of the house of the perpetrator, who then shall be impaled on it. That's kind of drastic, isn't it? He wasn't messing around. The house shall be made a dunghill. I'll just leave that one alone. May the God who has established his name there overthrow any king or people that shall put forth a hand to alter this or to destroy this house of Jerusalem. I, Darius, make a decree. Let it be done with all diligence. That ended the attempt to sabotage the building of the temple. Now, construction on this temple began several years before the construction on Nehemiah's wall that we heard about last week. That wall only took 52 days to finish, if you remember. But because of all of this letter writing, the temple took more than 20 years to finish. You gotta love bureaucracy, right? But why was it so important to rebuild the temple anyway? Well, there are a couple of reasons. First, the temple was a key part of the Israelites' identity as God's people. Second, their corporate worship centered on structure, on rituals, on things that had to happen. And the temple was the place to do that. Third, the temple was the place that God dwelled. It was God's house. Now, today, God, through the Holy Spirit, dwells in the human heart of those who follow Christ. But then, the Spirit of God actually resided in a building, a physical, actual building. Now, prior to the pandemic, a church building played an important part in our corporate worship. People would gather together in a church to worship, to share in each other's spiritual journeys, to gather socially, to see our friends. But the pandemic showed us that we don't necessarily need a building to be able to worship. Now, gathering together to worship is still an important thing to do. There's something unique that happens when God's people come together to share their faith with one another in worship. Now, yes, a person can certainly worship on their own, but they miss everything that happens when two or more are gathered. But post-pandemic, gathering for worship, while still very important, looks quite different. And that is what I would like to spend the rest of our time today talking about. We're going to use a group of people that we heard about in Ezra 3 to help with this. Let me share a couple verses with you again. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments were stationed to praise the Lord with trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, with cymbals, according to the directions of King David. And they sang responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord. Let me skip ahead a little bit. Here's the part that I really want you to hear. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of families, old people who had seen the first house on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of the people's weeping, for the people shouted so loudly that it was heard far away. Now, there is a possibility that those who were crying when they saw the foundation were crying because they were just so happy they were overcome with emotions. I don't know about you, but I cry at everything. I cry when I'm happy. I cry when I'm sad. I cry when I'm angry. So they were just overcome with emotion. They were so happy they started crying. But Most commentary authors agree that they were actually crying because they had seen the former temple. They remembered this grand structure that Solomon had built, and that they knew that this one being built right now, this new one, wouldn't and couldn't compare to the old one. Now, Zerubbabel was building the new temple, rebuilding the temple on the same site as Solomon's, but his was much smaller and it was much less grand. And this new temple would be yet another reminder to the Israelites of everything that they had lost. And this particular group of people who were crying were mourning that loss. Now, there is nothing wrong with grieving something that has been lost. In fact, it's important to do so. It doesn't matter what has been lost, if it's a person, a job, a relationship, a building. It's important to recognize its importance and to grieve what was but is no more. But it's also important not to remain there. Those Israelites who were crying over the temple couldn't embrace what Haggai had said, that this new temple, Zerubbabel's temple, would be bigger, it would be better, not necessarily in its physical structure, but in its ability to help this group of people be the people of God. As we return from a pandemic exile and work to rebuild our temple, to resume gathering together as a community of faith, we might find ourselves in one of these positions. We might find ourselves happy and joyful because we can come together and worship even though it's different. Or we might find ourselves weeping and sad because things aren't the same. As we re-enter Jerusalem, our temple, our church will be different. It already is in many ways. When quarantine kept people from gathering in groups and gathering to worship here, worship was moved online. And although some of us have returned in person, many are still choosing to continue to worship from home. Those folks that people are saying, hey, I haven't seen so-and-so in a long time. A lot of them are worshiping online still. But with that, that means that we might not see everyone that we used to see on a regular basis like we did before. Central Methodist also has a group of about 20 people who don't live anywhere close to Lawrence, and yet they worship here every week. Friends, there are churches that prior to the pandemic and even now don't have 20 people worshiping at all. We have an entire online congregation. That's great. But along with that means that we might not know everybody anymore. Weekly worship is different. You know that I make jokes about being on live TV. Chris Reisner, our church council chairperson, jokes with me that I've become a televangelist. I'll start pounding the pulpit next week, I promise. But jokes aside, that is really what we are doing. Our balcony has been converted to a production studio. Nothing as grand as that picture that you just saw, if you're online or if that you're looking at now, but it is a production studio nonetheless. Missy, our AV tech person, has become a TV producer and a director, framing and changing shots, giving cues to those of us who are here in front. You hear it as you're sitting here in person. 3 minutes, 1 minute, to let us know when we are going live. When worship is planned, now it must include thinking about how things are going to appear on camera. Folks, they didn't teach me to be a set designer in seminary or how to dress. And know not to wear green, because you become a green screen and someone can take you and make you look like anything they want when you're wearing the color green. These are jokes. You can laugh. Chalk that up to stuff that you're not taught in seminary. We have to think about how an online audience is going to look. We have to think about how we make an online audience feel like they are part. So you see me looking in the camera more instead of looking only at you. There are lights up here on the chancel, which means it gets really hot up here. So if you're cold out there, I'm sorry. All of these things are very different, not just for you, but for those of us who are up here and for those of us who are planning worship on a weekly basis. But worship isn't the only thing that has or will change. We'll be redesigning our Sunday school program for the fall. We've had to revamp the way communication happens. We're relying more heavily on email and digital formats because sending paper copies to 85 or 90 families is expensive. And so we've asked you to start watching your cell phone, start watching your email to help us out with this. Remember, the Jerusalem that we are returning to doesn't look the same. And so the church must adapt. How we go about being in community with each other is different, but being a community has not changed. And to be part of a community, a person has to be in the community. Where it was once easier to be part of a community, now it might take a little more effort. I should also point out that when Cyrus the Great allowed the Israelites to return to the Promised Land, not all of them packed up and were headed home. Another change that we face is that some members of this community might not return. Studies show that it takes 60 days to cultivate a new habit. We have had 425 days to cultivate the habit of not coming to church. Some have filled that time with new things. Others have joined other faith communities. I realize that this is a lot of change. And I can't stand here and say to you that there won't be more, that all of the change is done. What I can say to you for certain is that how Central United Methodist moves forward from here is very, very important. The form and substance of worship and church has always had to change to meet the challenges of a new generation. If God's church, if this church is going to survive and continue being the hands and feet of Christ, it must change to reach a post-Christian generation that is inherently distrusting of people who say one thing yet do another, of people who are more concerned about themselves than others, of people that they do not see being living examples of Christ. As we go about rebuilding our temple, we are each faced with some choices. Some might choose to be one of the lamenters, one crying at the foundation of the new temple, mourning what was once, but will never be again. Some might choose to be among those who rejoice loudly, shouting and praising God. Some might be like the foreign officials and try to sabotage the work. Some might be among those who choose not to return to Jerusalem at all. As decisions are made, I want to read Ezra 3:13 one more time for you. The people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of the people's weeping, for the people shouted so loudly that the sound was heard far away. The crying, the weeping wasn't heard over the shouting and the rejoicing. Many more people were excited that the building had started and that the crying was drowned out by the rejoicing. Let me say that again. So many were excited and happy and rejoicing that they drowned out the cries. This day, I choose to rejoice. I hope you will too. Let's pray. Holy and eternal God, you don't need a temple to reside in, for you reside in our hearts. But we, your children, long for a place to gather in community with each other. As we return to the community that is Central United Methodist, help us to mourn the things that were but are no longer, while looking forward to what is to come. Turn our sorrows into rejoicing. Lead us to become the church you would have us be, one that shares your love, grace, and mercy to a world that needs it so desperately. Lead us in our strivings to fulfill the call you have given us to make disciples of Jesus Christ. It is in that name that we pray. Amen. As we continue our journey into our new Jerusalem, several things that we need to know as we go along. One thing that hasn't changed: our church depends on your generous giving to be able to fulfill our ministries. And so we thank everybody who has continued to faithfully support this church with your tithes and your offerings and your gifts. If you are looking for ways to be able to do that, we have an offering plate for those who are coming in person. It is just outside our sanctuary room here that you can deposit your gifts into. Mailing your offerings to the church, I know many people are continuing to do that, and our address can be found on our website, which is lawrencecentral.org. Also on our website is an online giving portal that if you click on it, when it says giving, it will take you to a safe and secure site to be able to donate online. So as these gifts continue to come into our church and to continue to bless not only our ministries here, but the people that we are reaching out to from this church, let's take a moment to bless and consecrate those gifts that have come in this last week. I would invite Pastor Liz to come at this time and lead us in a prayer of dedication.
Let us pray. Almighty Creator, you have blessed us with abundant life and steadfast love. We offer these gifts to you, asking that your Holy Spirit will bless them and use them to shower grace and love upon all those both near and far. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Liz. A couple of announcements before we depart from this time. I shared with you last week that our conference, the Great Plains Conference annual conference, was held this last week. It was held online because of the pandemic. Just the most basic of business decisions were made. We voted on the conference budget. We voted on the conference officers, but the thing that pertains to this church is appointments were set, and I have been reappointed to Central United Methodist for the 2021-2022 appointive year, and so I am so happy that I get to come back and bless you, and more importantly, break the cycle of pastors only being here 3 years. This is a good thing. This is a good thing. Pastor Liz has also been reappointed. Liz is technically what is known in the Methodist jargon as on loan. Her conference membership is in Northern Illinois, and so her bishop in Northern Illinois lets our bishop appoint her here. And so we are happy that that relationship continues. We also are excited because Liz will be ordained fully this year at her annual conference. And so as we get more information on that, through the wonder that is technology, we will be able to be with her as she is in the Chicago area being ordained, and we are here in Kansas. So when that information is decided and we know when ordination will be, we'll have a party here, a watch party. We'll be cheering you on here from Lawrence. Excuse me, let me get a drink, lest I start choking on myself again. And there's one other appointment that I need to make the congregation aware of. In the United Methodist Church, we have something that is called a certified lay minister. These are people who can act in a pastoral capacity for churches, and we have one of those. It is actually my husband, Todd, and Todd has been appointed to pastor Centenary United Methodist Church on the other side of the river here in Lawrence, and so we will be having some changes here within our structure and some of the tasks that Todd has been doing. We will, goodness, I'm so sorry. We will need to find other folks to do those as well. Yes, thank you. This is why an associate pastor is important. And then the other thing I would share with you, normally when we have annual conference, there are a lot of clergy who have small children, and so childcare is provided. This year, for those kids, they received an annual conference in a box. And I think the clergy actually had more fun with the annual conference in the box because we had a flat bishop. If you remember the childhood books, Flat Stanley, this comes from that, and the bishop has been doing a lot of interesting things that he might not be aware of with our flat bishop. But we are actually going to be blessed with a sermon that he recorded for churches in a couple of weeks. But if you were interested in having a flat bishop, let me know. I can get you one. Our Jerusalem might not look the same, but one thing that does not change is we are God's church. The church isn't a building, it isn't a steeple. The church is God's people. As we rebuild our temple to however it will look, let us remember this. Our closing hymn this day is We Are the Church. If you would stand, if you are able to and would like to hear this in person, I would invite you to do that. But let us all join in singing our song, We Are the Church. The words will be on your screen. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. you are here in person, I would invite you after the benediction to have a seat as Karen blesses us with a postlude before you depart from the sanctuary. But now let us all receive the benediction. Go to dream dreams of a new creation. Go to make God's visions a reality in our world. Go with the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen.